Hi. In this lecture, we will discuss one particular software modeling technique, decision tables. Decision tables can be used to model how a combination of conditions should lead to a given action. The resulting decision tables are easy to understand and can be validated by domain experts. Furthermore, testers can use decision tables for the systematic derivation of test cases in order to verify that the system under test correctly implements the required conditional logic. Here, you can see a very simple example of a decision table. I derived it from a website of a Dutch phone company, which lets users click various options and then determines a price per month. In this simplified table, the price per month is determined by two conditions. And the conditions are whether the subscription is for national, which is cheaper, or international, more expensive. That's on the first row. And the second condition is whether the customer is willing to renew automatically, which would also be cheaper. At the bottom, in bold, we see the actual outcome or the action as determined by the conditions. In this case, the outcomes are different monthly prices. In general, multiple action columns can be added, but here we have listed just one. The columns, green and blue at the right, give the different variants, also called rules, of the decision table. In this case, there are four. The first variant describes the cheapest subscription, 10 euros per month, limited to national usage, and with an obligation to automated renewal. The fourth column is the most expensive one, 32 euros per month, with usage across the world and the possibility to cancel any moment. As a slightly more complex example, consider an extra condition shown in the third row. If you, as a potential buyer, are a loyal customer already, you deserve a reduction. And to make the logic a little more interesting, here we assume a customer can either get loyalty reduction or auto-renewal reduction, but not both. To model this, in the example, you don't just see true and false values for conditions, you also see DC, which is short for don't care. In the first column, this indicates that if we have auto-renewal already, the T value, whether the customer is loyal as well doesn't matter. That's the DC value. Likewise, if the customer is loyal, second column, picking auto-renewal makes no difference. Well, these don't care values are essentially an abbreviation for two separate columns, for the true and the false case, which are identical except for the DC value. Well, if we expand each DC value, we get, in this table, four extra variants, or columns. We can see that variants 1 and 3 are exactly the same, even though they were derived from different expansions of different DC cells, shown in orange here. The table is in this case well designed in the sense that these two variants share the same action. The reduced price is 10 euros in both cases. In general, as a designer of a decision table, you should be careful to minimize overlapping and ensure consistency if there is overlap. If we omit the duplicate columns, we arrive at the simpler table shown here. With three conditions and eight variants, it shows the maximum number of variants. In general, if we have n conditions, rows, this leads to 2 to the power of n possible variants, columns. The number of specified variants, however, can be smaller, even with don't care cells expanded. The common meaning in such cases is that the remaining variants should exhibit some form of default behavior. The default could be the most common case, the price is 10 euros, unless. Alternatively, it could be an error marker, like in all other cases, throw invalid configuration exception. Since the actual system must implement these implicit cases, it is good practice to make this default behavior explicit and to test for it as well. Well, the mobile plan example given here is relatively simple with just three conditions. Decision tables in practice can have many more conditions. For example, the actual mobile plan has several more conditions, bandwidth limits, phone minutes, type of previous subscription, etc. This then easily leads to, in this case, at least 6 conditions, and 2 to the power of 6 is 64 variants. Well, to get a feeling for the complexity and usefulness of decision tables, I encourage you to look out for decision logic in the applications you are working on. Such logic can be hidden in your user stories, in documents from your clients, or in the source code you are working on. Once you have identified such logic, try to turn it into a well-structured decision table. In the remainder of these lectures, we will cover how you can then turn your decision tables into relevant test cases.